Of all the clashes between the British and German navies in the 20th century, the Battle of Jutland during the First World War was the biggest and the deadliest. Britain had more ships and superior firepower. The public expected a walkover. But the outcome of the battle shook the nation to its core. Thousands of British sailors lost their lives in less than 24 hours. Recriminations followed. The truth was distorted.
Signatures were forged. Documents were fiddled with.
The reputation of the admiral who led the battle was ruined. Now, 100 years on, his grandson is determined to put that right.
I do feel that an injustice has been done. This story of Jutland needs to be told in the right way, once and for all.
Controversy has plagued Jutland ever since the battle. For the first time, an expedition is setting out to find all the ships that were lost. Armed with state-of-the-art sonar, they will scan the seabed in forensic detail, building an accurate map of the site and revealing for the first time what really happened.
This is what archaeology can do. Show us the truth, because the shipwrecks don't lie.
Truths will emerge from the depths, completing the picture of the final moments of lives lost as we bring the battleships back from the dead. In May 1916, the First World War had been raging for 2 years. Jutland took place just a month before the Battle of the Somme.
For many, you think World War I, you think of trench warfare. And yet Jutland was the big battle that the Royal Navy had wanted to have with the German High Seas Fleet. It's the battle the Kaiser had wanted to have with his fleet. And that clash, that epic clash, should have been the type of thing that would have decided a war. It should have been a Trafalgar.
Nelson's decisive naval victory at Trafalgar in 1805 meant that Britannia had ruled the waves for over 100 years. But in the early 20th century, a naval arms race between Britain and Germany saw the development of dreadnoughts, the biggest, fastest, most powerful ships the world had ever seen. On the eve of the First World War, Britain led the race, its supremacy a source of national pride and anticipation.
The public expected that fleet to be used. They expected, therefore, if war broke out, that the Royal Navy was going to win a decisive battle, and this would play a major role in the overall victory of the British Empire.
In Britain, the Admiralty believed the fleet's first task was a blockade. Ensuring enemy ships never left the North Sea would starve their economy. Germany wanted to break the stranglehold, and on May the 31st, 1916, her navy went looking for a fight. The glorious battle both nations yearned for proved far from decisive. There were huge losses on both sides. 6,000 British sailors died, and 2,500 Germans. Germany declared a famous victory, as Britain had lost more men and more ships. Jutland was no Trafalgar. Far from being another Nelson, the admiral who led the battle, John Jellicoe, was sidelined and later sacked. He was powerless to prevent the spinning of events that tarnished his reputation. A small bust of him lies forgotten in a corner of Trafalgar Square, overshadowed by Nelson's column, which towers nearly 170 feet into the air. Jellicoe is largely ignored by an indifferent public. But at the family home in Wiltshire, Nick Jellicoe is determined that his grandfather should be remembered for who he really was.
So I thought I'd take out some of the old albums we have, and we've got a rather amazing one, actually, Alan.
HMS Iron Duke, his flagship.
Some of the photos in here are just really remarkable. There's actually even one of the Admiral as a cadet. This is a photograph of my grandfather. It's aged about, I guess, 1874. It must be about 15. And the Admiral has a sort of rather odd way of sort of standing, hand on his hip, rather sort of nonchalant, a little cocky. It certainly wasn't the character that he grew up to be. He became a very modest man. But that's a lovely photograph of him.
After Jutland, John Jellicoe was heavily criticized. He had failed to sink Germany's fleet, despite his superior force and firepower. An official report blamed him for excessive caution. Recently, Nick's brother Johnny made an extraordinary discovery. It made them suspect the official report did not tell the whole story.
So this is actually where Johnny found the charts. I mean, it was, you can see up here, it was just all piles of wallpaper. And there was no way that anybody knew just what a treasure was sort of sitting there. When he brought them down and showed them to me, I mean, I was astonished, you can imagine. These probably hadn't seen the light of day, well, at least since the family's been living in this house. So this is what we found. When Johnny and I kind of unrolled this, I mean, both of us sort of said immediately, it's Harper. It was signed Harper, Battle of Jutland. But we weren't sure for quite a while just how important or significant these kind of charts were.
John Harper was the Navy's senior navigation officer. After Jutland, he was tasked with producing a factual record of the day's action and to chart all of the ship's movements. But in the recriminations that followed, his charts were never published. Now Nick has been offered the chance to join a scientific expedition to unearth new evidence. Coupled with his rare, unpublished charts, the expedition could have far-reaching significance for the truth about the First World War's deadliest battle at sea. He's going to be accompanying marine archaeologist Dr. Innes McCartney, the world's leading expert on the underwater geography of the battle site.
Well, I mean, we first started looking at the Jutland wrecks back in 2000. Then it was a matter of putting on our diving equipment, swimming around the outside of the larger ones, looking at them in awe, and trying to understand how we're going to interpret these, because they're huge. And you can only see small parts of them on any specific dive. What we're going to do this time, which is unprecedented, is to use absolute state-of-the-art high-resolution geophysics, which will allow us to map each shipwreck. And I'm genuinely hoping that the interpretations we'll be able to make on what's there will fundamentally reshape how we understand the battle. But the genuine new information lies on the bottom of the ocean.
It was off the coast of the Jutland Peninsula in Denmark that the world's two biggest battleship fleets finally met.
Innes?
Yeah, we're here. This is it. This is the base of the Jutland.
Innes and Nick will join the Vina, the expedition's specially equipped survey ship. For Innes, it's a chance to make new discoveries. And for Nick, it's an opportunity to travel in his grandfather's wake.
What's nice about this is having 6 days looking at all the wrecks of Jutland, which is something that I never dreamed I'd be doing, but doing it with, you know, people who are as passionate about this as I am.
With expedition leader Gert Andersen at the helm and his Danish crew, they will examine an area of 4,000 square miles. The most comprehensive map of the battle site ever will reveal all the sunken ships for the first time.
All those ships are still out there, on the bottom, capable of telling their own story. And in that, I think increasingly what we find is that the official record isn't always correct.
The outcome of the expedition will fundamentally alter our understanding of the greatest naval battle in modern history. Mm-hmm. Marine archaeologist Dr. Innes McCartney is leading a unique scientific expedition to explore the Jutland shipwrecks in the North Sea. He is accompanied by Nick Jellicoe, grandson of the admiral who led the British fleet. To date, only a handful of the ships have been located. Many questions about the battle remain. If the expedition can pinpoint more of the wrecks, Nick will discover which is closer to the truth. The unpublished charts he found, or the official account that defamed his grandfather. Previously, diving has only provided a partial view of the shipwrecks. New sonar technology will enable Innes and his team to produce incredibly accurate maps of the wreckage. The data will then be transformed into three-dimensional images that can be closely examined from every angle. This new view of the shipwrecks will rewrite the history of the Battle of Jutland. In the dead of night, on the 30th of May 1916, the British Grand Fleet, led by Admiral Sir John Jellicoe, slipped anchor from Scapa Flow in Scotland. At the same time, his Vice Admiral Sir David Beatty led out an advance party including six battle cruisers. They set off 200 miles south. With 151 ships and 100,000 men, it was the largest assembly of the most powerful fleets the world has ever known. Jellicoe and Beatty were to rendezvous on the 31st of May and lie in wait. They knew from radio intercepts that the unsuspecting Germans would be venturing into the North Sea that day. The British fleet was commanded by two men who couldn't have been more different. Jellicoe came from a modest background. After a conventional education, he joined the Navy as an officer cadet, working his way up to the top.
Jellicoe was a very attractive personality, very thorough, very human, very good manager. But Jellicoe had one great defect, in my opinion. He was far too cautious.
By contrast, Beatty was born into a well-to-do Anglo-Irish family. His early education focused on horsemanship, hunting, and how to be a gentleman.
Beatty was a man of style. He even designed his own uniform. He was a raffish figure, very buccaneering, very swashbuckling, not very competent, not a good fleet commander.
Just a few hours after Jellicoe and Beatty left port, Admiral Reinhard Scheer, commander of the German High Seas Fleet, set off. With him were 99 ships, an armada a third smaller than the British fleet. It included his scouting party of five battlecruisers under the command of Vice Admiral Franz Hipper. At 2:20 on the afternoon of the 31st of May, sightings of Hipper's battlecruisers were reported to Beatty. Without waiting for backup or informing Jellicoe, the British battlecruiser commander turned southeast in pursuit. An hour later, Hipper spotted Beatty advancing towards him. It was the moment everyone had been waiting for. At 10 to 4 in the afternoon, Hipper's flagship, the Lutzow, opened fire. This rare photograph captures that dramatic moment. The Lutzow and Beatty's own flagship, HMS Lion, engaged in a fierce firefight. A 12-inch shell from the Lutzow scored a direct hit on Lion's central turret. 99 men were killed. Worse was to come. 14 minutes into the exchange of fire, at the end of Beatty's line, HMS Indefatigable was hit by three German shells. Soon afterwards, she was struck again on her forward turret. At 2 minutes past four, observers reported a huge explosion. She sank with the loss of 1,017 lives. Aboard the expedition vessel, Innes and Nick are approaching the site of the wreck of the Indefatigable. They are hoping to answer some outstanding questions about her fate. One famous photograph appears to show her last moments, but doesn't tell us everything. Eyewitness accounts are unreliable, clouded by a limited perspective, smoke from the guns and the fog of war. Diving the site has its limitations.
This site we first examined 14 years ago by diving it, and it was very dispersed, and it was very difficult to really make sense of what we were looking at. I mean, we saw turrets, we saw guns, we saw boilers, we saw all the features that you see on these large Grand Fleet wrecks, but it was very difficult to make sense of them in terms of how the ship was actually lying.
Exactly what happened to the Indefatigable has been unclear for 100 years. New multi-beam scans are a revelation.
Even in the few minutes that I've had since it first started appearing on the computer screens, I can say straight away that it is going to change the way we look at the last few minutes of this vessel. I mean, it was destroyed with over 1,000 men on board. There were only 2 survivors. The multi-beam image is showing us a pattern of that destruction that is tragic, horrific, and incredibly violent, and the explanation why 1,000 people died.
There were no movie cameras at Jutland. One ship that took part in the battle, HMS Barham, was caught on film when it was sunk in the Second World War. The film of those terrifying last few moments gives some idea of what it must have been like for the men aboard HMS Indefatigable. A first-hand account by one of the only 2 survivors who had climbed the ship's mast gives a glimpse of the carnage.
There was a terrific explosion on board the ship. The magazines went. I also saw guns going up in the air, just like matchsticks. Bodies and everything. Within half a minute, she turned right over and was gone. I was 180 foot up and was thrown clear of the ship. When I came up, there was another fellow, Jimmy Green. We got a piece of wood. A few minutes afterwards, some shells came over us and Jim was minus his head.
The multi-beam reveals the Indefatigable's final moments in forensic detail. It has produced a remarkable new insight. It wasn't the bursting shell that did the damage, but a second explosion in the ship's magazine. In seconds, the blast reduced a 20,000-ton warship to shrapnel, claiming over 1,000 lives.
Looking at it, it's reminiscent of an aerial photograph of a village that has been destroyed by artillery fire. There are just craters all over the seabed as far as you can see. And you couldn't depict a more violent end to a battleship in any other way if you tried. To see this today for the first time, genuinely revelatory and quite astonishing, and at the same time tragic and very, very moving, I have to say. I'm a bit slightly choked, you know.
There is another key moment of the battle that Innes is keen to investigate. Just minutes after the loss of Indefatigable, the British were to suffer an even greater catastrophe. The Queen Mary was one of the biggest and most powerful of all the battle cruisers, the pride of the Royal Navy. Now, she found herself under relentless bombardment by not just one, but 2 German battlecruisers. Less than an hour into the battlecruiser action, she too exploded. She plummeted to the sea floor. The Queen Mary was Britain's biggest naval loss of the First World War. 1,266 sailors killed in an instant.
This whole seabed is a cemetery. There were very, very few survivors. The majority of the crew, they would have had no idea what would have happened to them. No idea what was going on above, and would have died without any sense of what was going on.
A sailor on board HMS Dublin witnessed what happened to the Queen Mary after she exploded.
The forepart suddenly shot ahead, listing slightly to port and veered towards us. In so doing, we noticed the height of the bow wave rising. This sorry load of humanity, listing further, now slowing up gently, slid into the deep. Oh, the sight of those poor fellows. I was to experience many dreams. Nightmares, more appropriate, for months afterwards.
In the case of Queen Mary, the damage is so obvious and is so cataclysmic that we can say straight away what has gone on. And in fact, the salvo which destroyed the ship, that detonation of the magazine underneath, has clearly split the ship clean in half at that point.
The new archaeology throws up a mystery. The most intact part of the wreckage is the back of the ship, the stern. The front section, the bow, disintegrated in the sheer force of the explosion. Given the ship's course, how did the stern come to be in front of the remains of the bow?
But what the multi-beam has done for us today is to draw together a lot of our thinking into this quite remarkable site plan.
The multi-beam finally confirms that it was not the front of the ship that shot forward as William Cave saw it. The bow had already shattered into a million pieces. Instead, Cave must have witnessed the stern shooting forward, traveling past the wreckage of the bow. By then, most of the men he imagined suffering on board, the stuff of his nightmares, would have already been dead. Even Beatty, with his bravado, was shocked by this second unexpected loss. "There is something wrong with our bloody ships today," he was heard to declare. In fact, there was nothing wrong with the ships. The fault lay in commanders demanding speed over safety.
There's a history in the Navy where rate of fire against your enemy is what wins you a fight. If you can fire faster than the chap is firing at you, you will take him out. So everybody working in the gun turret, their prime motive is to make sure that the guns are being loaded and fired as fast as they possibly can. And it has been suggested, not only in the battlecruiser fleet, but also in the main fleet itself, that a lot of the safety features, flash doors and the rest, were left open. But of course, if you do this, you potential for the ship to be nothing more than a tinderbox.
With the safety doors left open, and ammunition and explosives stacked around the turret and magazine, the turret shaft becomes like a fuse with a huge bomb below. One strike, and the whole ship goes up. Beatty would later be accused of being too gung-ho. In the first phase of the battle, he had pursued the Germans without waiting for backup. He had also allowed safety procedures to be relaxed on ships under his command to achieve a faster rate of fire.
I can't help feeling that there was an element of recklessness in the man, you know. He loved riding to the hounds. He obviously liked the thrill of the chase, and that's all fine and good. The criticism levelled at Beatty at the beginning of the Battle of Jutland is that perhaps the thrill of the chase slightly got the better of the man.
With his own ship battered, and two of his battlecruisers sunk after just an hour of combat, Beatty was in for another shock. Now he learned he was facing not just Hipper's scouting party, but the entire German high seas fleet. He led his ships in a U-turn, trying to entice the Germans towards the far bigger British Grand Fleet. However, he failed to communicate effectively with Jellicoe.
I don't think he was very good professionally. For example, when he's running back towards the Grand Fleet, pursued by the German fleet, Jellicoe signals him and says, what is the course of the German fleet. He's got to know where they're going so that he can make up his own disposition. This is a critical thing. Instead, what Jellicoe gets back is, they're right there, they're on my tail.
For Jellicoe, time was now critical.
I thought, what could I bring with me that would make this special? And so I brought the two watches that my grandfather used on the day. This one probably was used when he was making the deployment of the fleet, and watching this carefully and thinking, how many minutes do I have before the Germans arrive?
Nick's grandfather now had the opportunity to spring the greatest naval ambush in British history and make an even bigger name for himself than Nelson. The immediate outcome of the First World War was in his hands. Early on the evening of the 31st of May 1916, Admiral John Jellicoe, commander of the British fleet, lay in wait as his vice admiral, David Beattie, attempted to lure the German fleet into his path. Under the command of Reinhard Scheer, the smaller and less well-armed enemy were now heading into a trap.
The Germans are now facing a horizon full of enemy ships. Oh dear.
Jellicoe had very little information or time to act. He deployed his fleet against Scheer in a classic naval tactic, crossing the T.
So you want a situation in which a lot of your guns focus on him and not too many of his focus at you. If you're going along and someone else is across you, then he's in the ideal position. That's crossing the T.
Jellicoe positioned his ships brilliantly, but poor visibility prevented him from delivering the killer blow. Scheer saw the trap. He ordered the hardest fleet maneuver of all, turned every ship around at the same time, and sailed off. Later, to cover his escape, Scheer ordered his destroyers to launch a mass torpedo attack. Jellicoe faced another critical decision. To pursue Scheer, he'd have to steam into the oncoming torpedoes. To minimize losses, he'd need to turn away. He chose the safer course.
A lot of the criticism of Jellicoe turning away comes from an early account of Jutland by Winston Churchill. He had been First Lord of the Admiralty, but that doesn't make you an expert in naval warfare. He had been a cavalryman, and he was always very entranced by the idea of the offense, you attack. Well, sometimes if you attack and you just get wiped out, this is not a terribly good thing.
Jellicoe's defensive maneuver succeeded. Not one of the 31 German torpedoes hit home. The price was that the German high seas fleet was able to escape under the cover of darkness.
So by the following morning, the high sea fleet was well on its way and couldn't be caught. It had got away. The one opportunity to sink the high sea fleet had been let slip.
British woes were not over. During the night, HMS Black Prince became separated from the British fleet. Sometime after midnight, her crew spotted what they thought were Jellicoe's ships and fell into line. By the time they realized their mistake, it was too late. They had stumbled into the heart of the German fleet.
And almost at the same instant came the word. British, salvo, fire! An immense column of fire blazed up, and a devastating fire now opened up on the whole of the enemy ship. She failed to put up any effective defense. So quickly was she overwhelmed. And then the vessel sank, almost in silence.
857 men went down on Black Prince. There were no survivors. Innes is now hoping the new multi-beam technology might be able to solve a 100-year-old riddle.
It's always been a bit of a mysterious case because it went down in the middle of the night. There's practically no information on the British side about what happened to it. And where it is in an area where the underwater visibility isn't particularly good.
He wants to establish whether the severed piece of wreckage is the front or the rear of the ship. If he can figure out which way she was sailing when she was hit, he might be able to shed new light on the last moments of the men on board. This time, the multi-beam doesn't provide any answers. The team decide to use the remotely operated vehicle, or ROV, with its onboard camera.
We have the multi-beam, we can target the ROV right to a specific point, and we'll see if we can work out which end of this wreck is which, and then finally close the book on what the Black Prince was doing at the moment that it was sunk. You can be pretty... This site has been dived, but I bet you this piece never has. We're probably the first people ever to see this. That's brilliant, Gert. That's fantastic.
Coupled with the multi-beam scan, the ROV images enable Innes to answer for the first time what happened during Black Prince's last moments.
The question has always been, to what extent did the ship manage to extricate itself from this absolute nightmare?
The images reveal that the crew realized their mistake. In a desperate bid to escape, they managed to turn the ship around. Too late. Appalling loss of life wasn't confined to the British fleet. Hipper's flagship, the Lutzo, was repeatedly battered and bombarded by British forces during the course of the day. If the Queen Mary was Britain's greatest naval loss of the First World War, the Lutzo was Germany's.
This multi-beam shows the full length of the ship upside down, and the ship had taken in so much water because it had been hit 24 times by British shells. And when you compare that to the losses of our battle cruisers at Jutland that were only struck, if anything, sometimes only once or twice, it's a great testament to the design that went into the construction of this vessel.
The Lutzo had been so damaged that the Germans decided to deliberately sink her rather than let her fall into enemy hands. 1,150 surviving members of the crew were transferred to German ships that came alongside.
It was noticeable that all were suffering from severe memory loss and were unbalanced mentally. Several had to have their hands and feet bound to make transport for them possible, all shouting incessantly for water.
They were the lucky ones.
Tragically, there were German sailors trapped in the ship that they couldn't get out. So it was a matter of informing them down the voice pipes that the ship was going to be scuttled with them alive still in it.
Finally, the Lutzo, with the men still trapped on board, was torpedoed by a German escort ship.
As the torpedo exploded, the Lutzo's bow quickly dipped and the stern rose and stood on end. Then she heeled over and sank, forming a great whirlpool that carried everything within it into the depths.
When I think on Lutzo, I think of these sailors who didn't make it off the Lutzo, and that their comrades had to torpedo the ship to take it down, knowing that they were leaving friends there. And I think that's an incredibly sad story.
Anecdotally, at least, the last people evacuating Lutzo could hear them singing inside the ship through the voice pipes.
These are sort of moments in German naval history that I think must be remembered.
The expedition team are hoping that uncovering the truth about what sailors went through at Jutland will help to remember them properly.
Thank you. This week, we've steamed over 800 miles. We've now captured on the hard drive in the ship probably the resting places of all of the Jutland ships that are in this area. It's so far past the expectations I had. The next few weeks and months is going to be the process of going through it all and confirming what we have added to the Jutland story.
Only after his analysis will Innes know what the data reveals about the battle as a whole and about the actions of those in command. When Admiral Jellicoe and the British fleet returned from the Battle of Jutland, they didn't receive a hero's welcome.
Some ships were booed by dockyard mates. There was a feeling that all had not gone well. This was certainly not a new Trafalgar. And there was a great feeling of disappointment, of shock even.
The public demanded explanations. Those in charge came under extreme pressure to justify themselves. Beatty, despite the losses of his battlecruisers, sought to portray himself as the hero of Jutland, who had delivered the German fleet to Jellicoe only for him to fail to destroy it. Each man's supporters argued bitterly. Then came a chance for Beatty to protect his reputation. In December 1917, Jellicoe was dismissed. 3 years later, he was appointed governor of New Zealand. Beatty then replaced him as first sea lord in charge of all naval matters. With Jellicoe over 10,000 miles away, Beatty had free rein to rewrite history. Documents at the National Archives show how he did it.
So what we've got here is one of the earliest maps showing the track of the battlecruiser fleet. This was completed literally within a few hours of the ships returning to Rosyth.
In an official dispatch, Beatty boasted that at all times he was in contact with the enemy. Yet the original chart showed his ship had veered in a circle. The Vice Admiral had lost sight of the Germans. It gave Beatty a problem. John Harper, the Royal Navy's chief navigation officer, was compiling his factual account. Beatty needed the record to match his boast. He pressured his subordinate to alter the chart.
Harper says, I'm not going to make these changes unless I receive a written order from you. This Beatty refuses to do because if he does, his insistence on these changes is then placed in the public domain.
Beatty then went as far as to produce an alternative chart with his circling maneuver removed. He signed and dated it 1916, only with a style of signature he didn't start using until 1920, when he was made an Earl. Just his surname, with a bigger B.
He's then realised what he's done and has affected this rather unusual David in front of it. Now, as far as Harper is concerned, this shows completely that this track has been fabricated.
Certainly things got very fraught. Signatures were forged. Documents were fiddled with. This was quite extraordinary.
Attempts to rewrite history weren't solely down to the ego of senior officers. The destruction of the battlecruisers and loss of lives under Beatty's command raised awkward questions.
The real problem was the magazine practices, and no one wanted to go there because it was so incredibly embarrassing. Would the British have lost any battlecruisers at Jutland if they'd handled them properly? I don't think so. Think about how devastating that is. I think you're watching a smoke train.
The question remains, are the Harper charts accurate? If they are, they would help restore John Jellicoe's reputation despite Beatty's distortions. Innes McCartney's exploration of the Jutland battle site is complete. The survey has pinpointed, for the first time, the precise location of every ship sunk. Now he can compare the accurate map of the battle site to the Harper charts discovered at the family home by Jellicoe's grandsons.
How are you doing? Good to see you. Great journey. Come on in. Let's go up. So much to talk about. Great. The results I've got today are some quite startling discoveries. We've pegged out the battlefield, 100% accuracy. The battlefield, as depicted here, is only slightly smaller than the county of Yorkshire. So it's a massive area.
The map shows the 24 positions of the wrecks. The red dots are where Harper calculated the ship's positions to be, and the blue dots are where they actually are. Harper's charts are incredibly accurate, falling within 2 miles of the survey results in nearly all cases. For many years, the position of one of the wrecks cast doubt on Harper's accuracy. Indefatigable is not where the expert navigator thought it should be.
For the 15 years it's been since we found that wreck in 2001, there has been no satisfactory explanation for why this one would be inconsistent with the rest of Harper's work. What we've got here is a piece of ship from the bow, which we looked at with the ROV, to what we thought was the stern. That's 140 metres. And yet we know Indefatigable was 180 metres long. So yeah, there's 40 metres to be accounted for. And it was just nagging me. And I thought, well, if we get back there this year, just wondered whether we might pick something else up. And so after a couple of hours, lo and behold, that's what we were missing. Unbelievable.
Goodness me. So you found it. You found the missing 40 metres.
That's right, it is the stern of the ship. And in there you've got a barbette and you've got a turret, which I'll show you. Yeah. 500 metres away.
Wow.
The eyewitness account of the sinking of Indefatigable assumed the ship was still whole when she blew up. But she wasn't. The stern was blown off some minutes earlier, sending a shockwave through the ship that probably killed everyone on board. It was only when the remains of the ship blew up later that it was recorded as being destroyed.
We now know the sinking incident, which is probably just here, on the edge of the photograph, has happened perhaps 6 minutes earlier.
The difference between the actual time Indefatigable sunk and the recorded time explains why Harper, in his calculations, got the position of Indefatigable wrong.
Having established what really happened to Indefatigable, we can go back to Harper and look in totality at all of the positions he reported, mapped against all of the wrecks in the battlefield now found. Yeah. And we find a remarkably accurate portrayal of events.
This kind of really seems to validate, his work.
This is testament to the incredible work Harper and his team did. It confirms what many had long suspected, that the Harper record was an accurate depiction of events.
I'm astonished by this. I'm astonished by the revelation that one has 100 years after.
This is what archaeology can do. It can show us the truth, because the shipwrecks don't lie.
The fog is finally lifting from Jutland. Innes's multi-beam has revealed new forensic detail about what really happened in that fateful 24 hours. The total vindication of Harper's work leaves no doubt that Beatty attempted to manipulate the facts about the battle at the expense of his admiral, John Jellicoe. Now, the process of reassessing Jellicoe's reputation can begin. In 1925, Jellicoe returned to England from New Zealand and went into retirement. For the rest of his life, he refused to take part in the Jutland controversy. He died of pneumonia in 1935.
This is actually my grandfather, John Jellicoe. And what's remarkable, actually, is that David Beatty died 3 months later. And when he was at the funeral of John Jellicoe, he was deathly ill already. I think there's no doubt that the scandals, the controversy, the vitriol took a burden on both men, but, the burden of command must have been absolutely enormous.
For Nick, this has not just been a debate about the rights and wrongs of Jutland, but a deeply personal exploration of his family history and the character of his grandfather.
It's been an amazing journey to travel, to be honest. But I think now, more than ever, I feel the sense of professionalism that he had, that he wouldn't bow down to the pressure of the controversy. I hope that he feels what I'm doing now is correct, and that he would have approved of what I'm trying to do. And I'm really trying to make sure that, you know, this square is not forgotten for what it represents.
Some historians argue that Jellicoe was not timid, but prudent. He kept the British fleet intact, and the economic blockade of Germany was maintained.
In the end, the question is always who wins? And the British win. The British win because, at the end of the day, the Germans are still stuck on their side of the North Sea. They don't get out. The one time they do come out, once they spot the British, they go back in. End of story. Jellicoe really can lose the war in the afternoon, and he doesn't. That's called winning.
Other historians think calling the battle a British win is too strong.
If Jutland had been the great strategic victory that people say, there wouldn't have been this controversy. There wouldn't have been this backbiting. There wouldn't have been this argument. There wouldn't have been these forgeries. Everybody would have thought, oh, what a good job we did. But we didn't do a good job. And the result was years of controversy. Decades. A century even.
The Man vs. Nature collection, including Touching the Void and 127 Hours, is available now on all four. A three-year-old takes a tumble off his granny's trampoline, and that means 24 hours on Annie this Monday at 9. And next, Jennifer Lawrence has got to cane it, running for her life in the ultimate reality show, The Hunger Games.